بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يحده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending immense greetings and salutations upon the final Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. We find that unfortunately we're surrounded by many cliches or many statements around us, and many of us unfortunately don't live true to those statements that we are surrounded by. Amongst the calls that we find that we are surrounded by, that which is known, I'm sure many of you have probably come across this, is what is known as da'wah to salaf, call of the salaf, of calling back to the pristine classical orthodox views. That in no way is to undermine this call, because we know that the call has to be an orthodox call, that the way that we follow is the way of the pious predecessors, based upon the hadith in Bukhari, خَيْرُ النَّاسِ قَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. The best generation is my generation, then those people who come after it, then those people who come next. That is the orthodox way that every single Muslim should be searching for. As the Quran mentions, فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدْ اهْتَدَوْا. If you believe as they have believed, then you will be rightly guided. Likewise, Imam Shafi'i mentioned the consensus that he was searching for, إِجْمَاعُ الْأُمَّةِ, the consensus of the Ummah, or the following of the companions. Some mention that he read the Quran many times, some even exaggerate, if it's true, Wallahu A'lam, to 100 times, to find a verse inside the Quran which proves authenticity of following the companions. Then finally he came upon the verse inside Surah An-Nisa, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِكِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Whoever contends with the messenger after the evidence has been shown to that individual and follows a path other than the way of the believers. And here the question arises, مَنْ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, who are the believers? The believers are none other than the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, are the companions. So anybody who goes against the way of the companions or goes away from the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we know inside the Quran, فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ, if you differ amongst yourselves in anything, then refer it back to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise, we find inside the same surah, Surah An-Nisa, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجْرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتُ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ, and indeed by your Lord these people will never ever believe, حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجْرَ بَيْنَهُمْ, until they do not take you as a judge in the disputes that rise amongst themselves. And then when the judgment is given by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you find no ill feeling, no rancor inside one's heart. Sometimes you can tell a person it's a sunnah, but sometimes inside their heart they have this upsetting feeling that how can the Prophet Muhammad tell us to do this, or why is he telling us to do that? The real believers, even if you don't carry out that action, that station, inside your heart you find contentment. This is the commandment and encouragement of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's like what you find towards the end of Surah An-Nur, if I'm not mistaken, that those individuals who go against, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. There be a stern warning to those individuals who go against his commandments, commandments of the Quran, commandments of the Sunnah, that some severe calamity comes upon them. Imam Ahmad mentioned his calamity, one meaning has been given, is the meaning of shirk, that they begin to enter into associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or any other calamity of difficulties upon them. So we're not here to tarnish da'wah to salaf. We're just trying to give it more of a general understanding. What does it mean to follow the salaf? Not just in creed, but in one's character, one's behavior, one's whole life. That's what we want to extract today from their call that some of us have forgotten the whole call. As the Quran mentioned, يَا أَيُّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أُدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَةً وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌّ مُبِينٌ. Or you believe, enter into Islam in total submission. Don't pick and choose. أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْدِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْدِ. I believe in this, I don't believe in that, I reject this, I reject that, that doesn't really mean this. That's what some of us Muslims become, unfortunate. We only pick those things that are easy for us to do in our life or for us to adopt in our life. Those things which have hurdles or become difficult, we begin to shrug them aside or begin to make excuses. So da'wah to salaf has now become what? Da'wah to self. S-E-L-F. Me, myself and I. That's what some of us has become in our life. It just concerns myself or the people around me, whereby the whole slogan should be a wider comprehension, a wider understanding without undermining anything. No one is here to undermine any of the principles. And thus we want to take this shamuliyah, this complete concept, and return back to the Quran and see what the Quran says. The Quran mentions, وَأَنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاعْبُدُونَ. First time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this is inside Surah Al-Anbiya, the 21st chapter of the Quran. Anbiya is talking about the methodology of all of the prophets. Right inside there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, indeed this ummah is one ummah. Mentions this ummah is one nation. And I am your Lord, so obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second time is mentioned in the 23rd chapter of the Quran, which is known as Surah Al-Mu'minun. The reason why I mention is to help us to understand there's a great link. Because ulama who talk about Rabtul Ayat was Sur, who talk about the link between names of surahs and certain ayat linked to one another, certain passages linked to one another. So this verse is placed inside the surah of the believers. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Talking about the characteristics of the believers who are going to inherit paradise, the opening 10 ayat. So inside this surah we find, وَإِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاتَّقُونَ. Indeed, this ummah is one nation, and I am your Lord, so fear me, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the generic nature of the Qur'an to address Muslims on a global level. The Qur'an very rarely talks about specific individual Muslims. On rare occasion talks about al-muhajirun wal-ansar, and then once again, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ, and then those who follow them in goodness. So just praising them by name, but even we know that these names, Al-Muhajirun, not Muhajirun of today by the way, but this Al-Muhajirun that time, Wal-Ansar, these are praiseworthy names. And you read that these names, if a person falls into these Al-Qab, into these titles, and begins to give affiliation to these names over the truth, then this becomes a call of Jahiliyyah. This becomes ignorance. These two names are blessed names inside the Qur'an, and were blessed people close to the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When a small dispute broke out between a boy from amongst the Muhajirun and the Ansar, the boy from Al-Muhajirun called out, "Oh Muhajirun, come and help me." And the boy from Al-Ansar called out, "Oh Ansar, come and help me." So they began to fight amongst one another. This enraged the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A da'wah to jahiliyyah, a call of jahiliyyah, and I'm amongst you. So these are blessed names, but each one of them called to their own group, to their own people. كُلُّ حِزْبٍ بِمَا لَدَيْهِمْ فَرِحُونَ. Every single group rejoicing in that which it possesses. Whereby the Quran once again tells us, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ يُتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You're the best people ever raised up. You order the good and you forbid the evil. Like how you find, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٍ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. That there rise amongst you a group of people. Who are these group of people? Once again, it's the believers, the companions, ordering the good and forbidding the evil. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم منها. This is praising once again the companions. Remember the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But before that, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ. Hold fast to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Works of tafsir you find, hold fast to the Quran, to the Sunnah, to Al-Fara'id, to the Sharia, to Ta'atullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All these mutaradif, all these words, they all mean what? They all mean the same thing. Whether you say hold fast to the Sharia, hold fast to the Quran, hold fast to the Sunnah, hold fast to the life of the Prophet Muhammad, and stick to the obligatory things, all carries the same meaning. So that's the first lesson. Hold all of us fast to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And do not differ with one another. Remember the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you were enemies towards one another. And then we brought your hearts together. Another passage in the Quran, لَوْ أَنْفَقْتَ يَنِي مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Whatever you spend, whatever is upon the earth, on the earth and the heavens, يَنِي مَا أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ. You're not going to be able to bring their hearts together. So money doesn't bring hearts together. It's the same interest that brings people together. Love for the Quran and the Sunnah brings people together. So the companions read the ayah, this tafsir inside Surah Ali Imran, verse 104 or 105 or so that you find. In there you find clearly, that you read the tafsir inside Tafsir Ibn Kathir, that these people who were fighting were the two tribes of Al-Aws wal-Khazraj. There were two tribes that were living in Medina. And who was stirring up the trouble? Just like today, non-Muslims causing this friction. They used to fight over squabble, over silly things. Who won the horse race? Who came first? We were this, we were that. Years on end, they were fighting amongst one another. It wasn't until the coming of the Prophet Muhammad that he brought them together and reunited them. So the concept of divide and rule is not something that happened in 1947, whether it be the blessed land of Palestine or the blessed land of Pakistan was separated, etc. It wasn't in 1947. It's years, all the way from the time of the Prophet Muhammad of creating dissension. If you read Surah Al-Hujurat, read the tafsir of the 49th chapter of the Quran. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. Indeed, believers are what? They're brethren towards one another. Thus the Quran gives a new understanding of brothers. Brothers isn't blood brothers. As some of us may think, it's good if blood brothers are upon Iman and are related as well, like we find Musa and Harun alayhi salam, that exist as well. But the real relationship that you find of Akhuwatul Islamiyah is the love of the Quran and the Sunnah. Thus the Quran mentions about Nuh alayhi salam, when Nuh alayhi salam calls out, Innahu min ahli, he's from my family. And what does the Quran highlight? That he's not from your family. إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٍ. His actions are impious. So he's now removed from being your family. So the Quran comes along and gives a new dimension to what does it mean to be your family members. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. The believers are brethren, those who share the same cause, the same interest. So if you read Surah Al-Hujurat, that you find وَإِنْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. If two groups of the believers fight amongst themselves. The Quran doesn't say that one group are believers and the other group are disbelievers. The Quran says that if two groups of the believers fight amongst themselves, then reconcile. So here it's not saying they argue, they misunderstand. If they physically begin to fight one another, then you need to try to reconcile between the two. Not try to muster up more problems amongst Muslims. Read the tafsir of this ayah, you find that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he went to meet the leader of the hypocrites. He went to meet the leader of the hypocrites, knowing this individual is a hypocrite. So when he came to this individual said, يَنِي إِلَيْكَ عَنِّي. Get away from me, because indeed your donkey smells. So imagine this is a hypocrite, clear-cut hypocrite. He's saying about the Prophet Muhammad, get away from me because the smell that's coming from your riding beast, it smells. So one of the Ansar, he said, that wallahi, the smell of the donkey smells better than you. The smell of the ass smells better than you. You can wear whatever perfume, whatever cologne, whatever you want to wear today, you hypocrites, and make yourself look nice and presentable, but there's still a filthy smell that disseminates from you, from your hearts. So now a fight broke out, because this individual had his supporters, and they had their supporters, but the supporters he had were Muslims. They were believers. They began to throw stones, throw sandals, shoes towards one another. And thus we find that this individual, he stepped aside and he began to rub his hands of divide and rule. Just like today, don't fight to break out amongst Muslims. Sounds very strange. There's been situations where we have to intervene, whereby Muslims have pulled out guns on one another. Pulled out guns over petty disputes. Or disputes going back to Jahiliyyah. He looked at me in this manner. He walked past me. He said this. He said this 10 years ago. I can't tolerate that. So what type of Muslim are you? What did the Prophet Muhammad tolerate inside his life? What did people say about him? How did they harm him? But what did he do? He never retaliated for himself. Never in his life. If he did retaliate, he retaliated for who? For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Ali radiallahu anhu, when he was wrestling a man, and he put the man down on the floor, then the man spat in his face. Ali could have taken out his sword, executed the man, could have beaten him, could have killed him. He got up and he walked away. The man said, why did you harm me? He said, when I wrestled you first, it's for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just messing about. When you spat in my face, it became something to do with my ego. Now it becomes my ego that I have to now retaliate against you. So I didn't want to do that, because now I know it's not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's all of us should ask ourselves deep down inside our hearts. The things that we do, is it lillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or is it for the ego? Is it for our own self? Is it for our own identity? The real believers do things only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thus you find the scholars have mentioned the most difficult thing for a Muslim, even amongst the scholars, is to check yourself, why are you doing something? Some of the right 40 years of my life, I never took a step forward, I never took a step back, except for thinking, why am I doing this? Is this for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is that what I really intend? Am I doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or am I doing it for something else? So likewise, this is the global message of Islam. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ The call of a Muslim is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and carrying out righteous actions with that righteous call. Likewise, we find generic ahadith of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. وَكُونُوا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ إِخْوَانًا Be all of you brethren, brothers towards one another. These generic ahadith we want to mention, the Quranic verses, are quite crystal clear. You can go back to Riyadu Salihin and find all these ahadith there. Al-Muslim, akhul Muslim. لا يظلمه ولا يخذله. A Muslim is a brother to another Muslim. The hadith doesn't say, I'm a brother to you because you live in my area. I'm a brother to you because you follow the same sheikh I follow. It doesn't say that you're a brother to me because I follow the same madhab. It doesn't say I'm a brother to you because you come from the same country. It doesn't say you're a brother to me because I speak the same language. It doesn't say that. It said, Al-Muslim, akhul Muslim. The Muslim is a brother to another Muslim, irrespective of wherever they come from. That's the prophetic teachings. Like you find Al-Muslim, من سلم المسلمون من لسانه ويده. The Muslim is one that other Muslims are what? Safe from your tongue and safe from your hand. That's what it means. One Muslim to another Muslim. When you say Assalamu alaikum, one meaning, ulama mentioned, what is the meaning of this? You are now safe from me. You don't need to worry about me being treacherous towards you. لا يظلمه ولا يخذله. Muslim doesn't oppress another Muslim, doesn't betray him, doesn't let him down, doesn't forsake him, doesn't speak ill of him, makes 70 excuses for his Muslim brother. That's what it means. Even the hadith, and I'm sure most of us have memorized by now, that لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. None of you truly believes until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. Other wordings of wine, من الخير, from the good things. You like something good for yourself, then you should want that for your brother as well. And these type of ahadith that we find, لا يؤمنوا أحدكم. None of you truly believes, because some people try to go to an extreme view, that this means, أن هذا الشخص هو كافر. This person is a disbeliever. Because the hadith says, لا يؤمنوا أحدكم. None of you believes. And this is not the correct interpretation of such a hadith. When you come across such a hadith about the person does not believe, the person is a disbeliever, or the person reviles a person or does this action, the most clearest and the safest stance in reference to another Muslim is not to take it to being a disbeliever. It means أن هذا الشخص هو ناقص الإيمان. نقص أو خلل في عقيدته أو في إيمانه. This person is deficient inside the Iman and the interpretation of Iman. No one should take that. That's what Ibn Taymiyyah in his fatwa highlights. Every single action of kufr does not mean you become a kafir. Bear that in mind, because many young individuals, as soon as you see a person doing something haram or even doing kufr, فَيَحْكُمْ عَلَيْهِ فيقولون أنه كافر. That's what many young Muslims are doing at the moment. They see someone doing something haram and straight away say he's a kafir. وَإِنْ سَرَقَ وَإِنْ زَنَى وَإِنْ شَرِبَ الْخَمَرِ. Even the person drank alcohol in front of you, committed adultery in front of you, stole in front of you. فَلَا تَحْكُمْ عَلَيْهِ. Don't judge upon another Muslim. هُنَاكْ ضَوَابِدْ وَالشُّرُودْ. There's conditions, applications. Nobody can just come along and start spilling the blood of a Muslim. In the Sharia, it's the opposite. You take the Muslim على ظاهره. You take the Muslim upon the apparency. And the apparency of every single Muslim, أنه Muslim. أما كافر, that's the opposite. The essence of a kafir is what? أنه كافر. من شك في كفرهم فهو كافر. Whoever doubts them being disbelievers becomes what? A disbeliever. But we do the opposite. We try to make excuses for who? For the kuffar. And then we don't make excuses for who? For the Muslims. It's the opposite principle. You make all excuses for a Muslim. And there's no excuses for these individuals. ذَرْهُمْ يَأْكُلُوا وَيَتَمَتَّعُوا. Leave them alone to eat and drink. Eventually they find that time will come over these individuals. يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ عَنِ الْآخِرَةِ هُمْ غَافِلُونَ. That's all that they know, this eating, drinking, enjoying themselves of the dunya. That's all that they know. As for the akhirah, هُمْ غَافِلُونَ, the heedless individuals. So we as Muslims, they claimed to have love and devotion towards any human conventions or the Geneva Convention that was established after what? 60-70 million people were killed. Okay, about 70 million people killed throughout World War I and World War II, and then finally in 1943 they made this convention about giving people their rights and prisoners of war, which obviously doesn't exist for Muslims. There's no concept of prisoners of war for us. We're just put in orange suits and we're tortured and whatever it may be and the rest that goes with it. That's the reality. They find our blood to be cheap. There's no value to us. They care more about a dog or a cat that dies in the streets, not to say we don't care about animals, but then all hell would break out loose. But if a Muslim suffering, you know, just brush that aside. Even some of us Muslims, we just brush it aside. In some athar that you find, that the blood of a Muslim is more sacred than the walls of the Kaaba. If the Kaaba is broken brick by brick, if it's broken apart, then this is something small. It's something small in comparison to the spilling the drop of one blood of a Muslim. Because we know that many of us Muslims get emotional, don't we, about these things. How can they depict the Kaaba like this? How can someone destroy the Kaaba? Even that we know from the minor signs and entering just into the major signs or after the major signs are completed will be the destruction of the Kaaba when there will be no more good people left. It will be destroyed. But we know that Muslims are emotional about the symbols. Sha'a'ir Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if those symbols are broken brick by brick, the Kaaba is dismantled, that's something belittling. That's not something major. Because more major than that is one small drop of a blood dropping on the floor of a Muslim is more troublesome in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the destruction of the Kaaba. So with that, we need to bear that in mind, that there are rights and regulations that belong to the Muslims. As soon as we become Muslims or we understand the concept of Islam, then the global message begins to carry and begins to concern us. The more that we have a position, the more that we have authority, the more that we have wealth, whatever we have, then the more we need to begin to respond to those people. Because what some of these people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed them in a difficult situation. Hikmatullahi baligha, the immense wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that there will be certain things that begin to take place that we cannot understand as human beings. But some of these things take place to do what? To wake up the rest of the Muslims. Sometimes many Muslims ask questions, you know, a young sister being oppressed, children being whatever it may be happening to them. What's the benefit of that? There is a great benefit that we cannot begin to understand. That in those small atrocities, yes, they're grave for those people. In those small atrocities, what begins to take place? You find at times, thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, at times what? Millions will begin to wake up. So small things take place, but it wakes up the rest of us individuals. It makes us begin to think. ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس ليذيقهم بعد الذي عملوا لعلهم يرجعون. Fasad, corruption has appeared upon the land and the oceans because what man has sent forth with his own actions. You may taste the fruits of your own actions and then you may do what? Return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for some of us it may sound very, very difficult.
But if you travel through Fasiru fil Ard, travel through the Muslim lands, you find many difficulties. And some of these difficulties concern that these people have carried out these actions by their own hands. For example, the land of Palestine is a blessed land to every single Muslim. But have you ever traveled to that land and seen what takes place? How many people come there to the daily prayers? Not many people. They can't be bothered. It sounds very harsh and crude, but some of us are very emotionally brainwashed with these things. But the reality is that the average individual, حتى يومنا هذا, in those blessed lands, ما يهتم بالشريعة الله سبحانه وتعالى, does not care less about the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why we have to move from the small elements to carry on striving and striving until we move away from 1% to 10% to 15% to 20% to 50% to 60, 70, 80. Then that change will begin to take place. Because you can see it in our own Muslim environment. How many people care about Islam? That's the reality. Yes, there may be few fringe movements that do understand the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the average masses, al-awam, they don't care. They don't really care about the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's whatever we see around us is a reflection of our own selves. That's a reality. So that's a reality we need to begin to understand. That doesn't mean that we begin to don't help these people. So some people may say that they've put themselves in that mess. You find these harsh statements. Some Muslims go around saying, well, they picked a fight with America, then let them live with that fight. Iraq went into suffering, whatever it may be, let them deal with it now. Somalia, this, or whatever it may be, true. It may be true. Wallahu alam, it may be possibly true. But what should we do? What should we do as Muslims now? What should we do as practitioners? Should we just turn away now? Yes, they may have had a bad aqa'id, corrupt beliefs. They may be involved in khurafat, inside innovations. They may have rejected the way of Islam. They may have become secularists, may have done this, they may have done that. Yes, it's all true. We agree to that. So what should we do? Just leave them alone? It's even been prophesied by the Prophet Muhammad SAW. In the hadith of Sunan Abi Dawood, إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَ وَأَخَذْتُمْ بِأَذْنَابِ بِالْبَقَرِ وَرَضِيتُمْ بِالزَّرْعِ وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادِ سَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ذُلَّ لَا يَنْزِعُوا حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم in the hadith in Sunan Abi Dawood and check by the late Muhaddith of Sham, Sheikh Nasruddin Al-Albani, rahmatullahi alayh. If you begin to deal with usury, with interest, is not Al-Banuk Al-Ribawiyya muntashira fil alam at the moment? Is not interest widely spread in the Muslim world at the moment? We can say whatever we want to say. Sheikh Adnan said this and Jazeera and he said this. It's not haram, it's not riba. That the essence is what? That the essence, it's riba. That's a reality. We are at war. Forget about Al-Amrikan, Wal-Kuffar, Wal-Allan, Wal-Allan. Yes, that's a small war. We are at war with, you know with who at the moment? We are war ma'Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are at war with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because no verse in the Quran highlights this. You can commit so many different sins in your life. Commit so many different sins. But whoever commits a sin of akhdhu riba wa aklu riba, of eating, of using interest, then Allah and His Messenger have declared war upon those people. Declared war. Because some of us, we think we're what? We're sha'abullahi mukhtar. We think we're the chosen children of God. God's not going to punish us. We're Muslims. That's what we think, don't we? You misunderstood the Quran. The whole message of the Quran, it rebukes as-sufaha, the foolish individuals, right in the beginning of Baqarah. Then it talks about al-Yahud, wal-Nasara, Ahlul Kitab, Mushrikeen. Then again, Al-Imran talks about al-Nasara once again, al-Nisa, about al-Munafiqoon, once again about al-Yahud, al-Nasara, al-Ma'ida, al-Nasara. We sit there thinking, look at them, look at these foolish individuals. But you know, ulama al-Tafasir have mentioned, al-Ibra bi'umum al-lafzi, la bi-khusus al-sabab. The lesson is to be taken from what? The generality of the words and not from the specifics of revelation. Don't sit there looking at them, they done this, they done that. Because you know what? لَتَتَّبِعَنَّ سُنَنَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ. You're going to follow the path and the methodology of the people that came before you. The companions asked, الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى قَالَ فَمَنْ. Who else are you, am I talking about? وَلَنْ تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعْ مِلَّتَهُمْ. These people never be happy with you until you don't follow their way of life. And that's what many of us will begin to do. Don't understand the Quran, listen to the Quran. Soon as Ramadan is going to be over now, كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَرَاءَ ظُهُورِهِمْ كَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. For the book of Allah behind their backs as if we don't know. وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَحْجُورًا. The messenger say, oh my Lord, my people have abandoned this Quran, left this Quran. Some of us only think the Quran is a form of tabarruk. That's it, just read the Quran. Yes, there is tabarruk. There's immense barakah. Alif, lam, meem. It's not 10 rewards. For alif, there's 10. For lam, there's 10. For meem, there's 10. 30 rewards. That's one element of the Quran. But what is a deeper element of the Quran? أن تحكم بشريعة الله سبحانه وتعالى. You judge by the book of the Quran. You judge by those ayat. They have a big powerful impact inside our lives. We begin to talk about this. Oh, well, that's just radical speech. We don't need the Quran. We don't need this. We don't need that. You can carry on reading the Quran all day long. You can read it all day long as far as the kuffar are concerned. By the minute you begin to say, فَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ أَوْ مُبَالِمُونَ فَاسِقُونَ. Not to claim that anybody is, but you begin to bring out the message of the Quran, then this becomes something which is dangerous. They don't want that. And nor do some Muslims don't want that as well, unfortunately. They don't want that. Don't want to say anything about any Muslim, but look throughout the Muslim world. Study in great detail. What do you find? Al-Qawaneen al-Wada'iyya. Man-made laws. Al-Qawaneen al-Amrikiyya, al-Britanniyya, al-Yunaniyya, al-Spaniyya, kada wa kada. All throughout our Muslim lands. Isn't it? That's the reality. You find nothing but what? Man-made laws. We're not talking about the average laws of stopping at traffic lights, whatever. That's different. That's not kufr. Some people may think stopping at the red lights, that's kufr. That's a man-made law. That's kufr. That's what some people go around saying. They don't understand the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These qawaneen, al-wada'iyya, these laws are good laws. Maslahatun nas. It's got nothing to do with kufr. If it's a red light, who built it? Japanese, American, who cares? It's just stop at red lights. Benefiting for who? For people. To tell people to line up nice and neatly at the bus stop, to line up outside the masjid, even the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The rules and regulations, switch off the lights, don't do this, don't do that. Oh, these somebody printed it up and wrote it on the masjid. We don't need to obey this. There's no obedience to this. هذا خربان العقل. They're crazy individuals. Don't understand the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The real difference that we find in the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in our judgments. Those disputes that concern us. So all these haram things that we do, then we say, no, the Quran doesn't really mean this. نؤول الآيات, make tafsir the ayat, make ta'wil of the ayat. It doesn't really mean riba. It doesn't really mean that. So when the messenger clearly stated that there will come a people, يستحلون الحرى والحرير والمعازر. People come and legalize zina, legalize شرب الخمر, legalize المعازر, musical instruments. Then what begins to happen? هذا حديث معلق, حديث عن. This hadith معلق, this hadith is not authentic, even inside Bukhari. All these doubts. في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا. In their hearts is a sickness. The believers of those individuals قالوا سمعنا وأطعنا. We hear and we obey. If you can't do something, no problem. No one's going to blame you. But inside your heart, have that these are the words of the Quran and Sunnah. Don't make ta'weedat. Don't come with what's known as da'watul al-tajaddudiyya, a da'wah of modernism. Wherever you go now, every single day you just find that, oh, hijab doesn't mean hijab anymore. Hijab means inside the heart. Lihya doesn't mean lihya anymore. Muhimman taqoon, yani sulukuka jayyida, hadhi ma tahtam bihadhi al-ashya. هذا كلام فاسد. This is evil words. If you don't want to do something, don't do it. فيك خير إن شاء الله. No problem. Don't make ta'wil. Don't interpret it at least about good manners. You know, you do this action, but you're bad in this, that, and the other. No, that's not what Islam is. You begin to shaddid ba'duna ba'da. We help one another. I don't have bad character. I have bad characteristics. I learn from you. You learn from me. We work together. We don't begin to blame one another and begin to dissect our own family unit. This is the biggest problem that we find. Our own Muslims dissect our own selves. Muslims come out and say, these things are not important. What is the parable of Muslim towards another Muslim that we find? Al-Muslim, yani yashuddu ba'duhu ba'da. A Muslim, al-Muslim kal-bunyan. The believer, the mu'min is like one building. That is pillar. The moment you take out one brick, you may not notice it now, but after a short while, that pillar will begin to weaken. That's what a believer is. Is one brick that's linked together. ثم شبك بين أصابعه صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then the person linked his fingers together. He said, this is the parable of the Muslim Ummah. If you're just on your own one hand, it's not very powerful. But when you link it together, it becomes a powerful unit. That's how the Muslims are towards one another. They are كأنهم بنيان مرصوص. As they're one solidified building. We can't even straighten our rows together. Once again, we find that trivial. But what we find in a hadith, if you don't straighten the rows, فَتَخْتَلِفُ قُلُوبَكُمْ, then your hearts will begin to differ. If we cannot stand straight in our rows together, you really think we're going to stand in rows of jihad? وَعِدُّ لَهُمْ مَسْتَطَعْتُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ. We can't take instructions from the imam. And that's what many of the ulama have highlighted. If you cannot take instructions from a person in authority above you, the imam, you can't take authority or instructions from any individual. And that's what, another sickness that we find inside this community, that we haven't been trained to take instruction. No one's saying that people should become tyrannical and harsh, whatever it may be. There needs to be a framework that people need to work underneath. When everybody's just free to do whatever they want to do, everybody wants to be any the chief, and you know, we got enough chiefs at the moment, we need more Indians, don't we? Eh? So we need to be able to learn to take instructions. Sometimes instructions are difficult to swallow, but that's part of tarbiyah. That sometimes you don't understand something, and a person can have much more experience. That's been resembled inside the seer of the Prophet Muhammad, that when he made that agreement with the non-Muslims in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah that we find, what happened? That many of the companions, they were upset that how can the Prophet Muhammad compromise? How can he make this agreement with them? But sometimes, exactly today, we look at the small picture, we don't look at the greater picture. We look at our benefit, we don't look at the greater benefit. Even today, outside the haram, if a person begins to pray extra prayers and you're blocking everybody from going around, then you know what they can do? They can pick you up and they can remove you. You can wail and shout and scream and say, they picked me up, I was busy praying, I was in khushu. You're only praying a nafal prayer. There's thousands of people who are doing what? Who want to go around the Kaaba. Or they want to bring a dead body inside there. Or they want to bring the imam inside there. So, maslahatul nas, your small impact has to be removed now to look at the greater picture. That's what we need to understand once again of Islam. Too many of us, we see the smaller picture of our own selves, of myself. We don't see the greater picture, that we could be harming the greater picture. So to keep the greater picture, we have to harm ourselves. Let us harm ourselves. There's no problem in that. No one should take that personally, because companions, as we mentioned, makes no difference to them. Place them at the front, place them at the back, place them in the middle, wherever you place them, they'll be any convicted or they'll be any convinced in what they have to carry out. So we find that this is just to highlight the essence of the global message of Islam and the role that we need to play towards our fellow brothers and sisters. What are the things that we can do? As now in Ramadan, we all eat well, we dress well, we sleep well, we have our family members around us. Is there anyone amongst us that can, as they say, place a hand on our heart and say, I'm suffering? Is there anyone that can say that I'm really suffering? We don't really know what, alhamdulillah, suffering is. So we should awwalan nashkurullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that our houses have not been collapsed. Our family members have been taken away from us. We don't know what we're going to eat or what we're going to drink. We have all of that in place. So we need to begin to think that in these final moments of Ramadan, just like we have the good things in this month of Ramadan, maybe we should begin to share some of those blessings. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. You're never going to attain piety until you don't spend of the things that you love. The Quran also mentions, وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Whoever removes the greed from their heart will become what? A successful individual. So all of us have an element of greed of the things of the dunya, which could be ja'iz, which is allowed. But I'm sure we all have something spare that we can help those individuals. So we find that giving of one's wealth, because we find that charity is not removed, or you know, wealth is not diminished by the giving of sadaqah. Some of us may think we give our wealth, it may be taken away, our wealth. And look at this country, the point in case, the whole presentation about Somalia, that we find that many young brothers don't seem to care. Because sometimes we always think, it's not my doorstep, Afghanistan's not my doorstep, Iraq's not my doorstep, Kashmir's not my doorstep, Somalia's not my doorstep, Shishan's not on my doorstep. All these places, they're not on my doorstep. It doesn't concern me. To be fair enough, I may watch the images from a distance, that's it. You know, we should be thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it's not on our doorstep. We should be thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not on our doorstep. Maybe those people got a stronger iman than we have. Sometimes you see the images, people's homes being destroyed, and you see people saying, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. For us, it's easy to say that. But when it really comes down to it, what do you find people saying? Oh, how can that happen to me? I thought I was a good Muslim. Why has Allah done that to me? Why am I the one that's suffering? Why are these hardships upon me? Couldn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala find anybody else? That's all words of kufr. But those people are saying quite clearly, to Allah we belong, to Allah we return. This belongs to Allah. And He can take it whenever He wants to take it. So their iman is possibly on a greater level than our iman. But we can't seem to recognize that. We think our iman is greater than them. And likewise, these tests and these shada'id, at times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places them to purify people. As the Quran mentions, Alif Lam Mim, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّا الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Beginning of Surah Al-Ankabut, do people think that they're going to say that we believe? وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. And you will never ever be tested in your life. Indeed, we did test the people that came before you, that Allah may reveal those people the truthful individuals and those who are the liars. And that's the same surah ends by mentioning, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Those who strive in our paths, we will open up the paths to them, all paths of goodness. And indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the doers of good. Like we find in Surah Al-Baqarah, we find, أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ وَلَمَّا يَأْتِكُمْ مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ مَسَّتْهُمُ الْبَأْسَاءُ وَالْضَرَّاءُ وَالزُّلْزِلُوا حَتَّى يَقُولَ الرَّسُولُ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ مَتَى نَصْرُ اللَّهِ أَلَا إِنَّ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ. أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ. Do you really think you're just going to stroll into paradise? That's what some of us we think. Do you really think you're just going to enter into paradise? Has not the parable come of the people that came before you, that afflictions and hardships came upon them, and the earth began to shake underneath them, till even the messenger underneath him began to say with him, when is the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to come? Indeed, the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something close by. And these people are calling out. Inside Surah An-Nisa that we find, the weak individuals amongst the men, the women and the children, send one, O Allah, from amongst us, a wali, a protector, and a nasir, and a helper. If you study this ayat carefully inside Surah An-Nisa, it doesn't say, Allah, you send the angels, it says, send from one amongst ourselves. Who does that refer to? From our own people. Who's going to come out and aid these people? Who's going to come out and assist these people? So the first thing that we can do is obviously that we find is to aid them financially, with food, with clothing, with shelter, whatever we can do. Like we find to pray for them. That in these final 10 nights of Ramadan, even this has become political for some people, that to pray for these people, it could open the doors of intelligence upon you, and this, that, and the other begins to take place. Well, in silence then. Pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in silence, in your own home, in the realms of darkness. Oh Allah, these are your servants. These are your servants who are being persecuted, who are being oppressed for many years. Hardships have come upon them. Alleviate their problems. Take away their sufferings. Take away their hardship. Yes, they may have done wrong actions. They may have not had right belief or carried out corruption, whatever it may be. But show your mercy towards these individuals. Take them out of their afflictions and these hardships. Is that now something sinful for us to do? Is that now something sinful for Muslim to pray that? And as we mentioned, we began with da'wah to salaf. You find that many, if you read the seerah of the nubala, any of the pious individuals, famous ulama, you find some of them were restless at night, wouldn't sleep at night. Was it because of a toothache? Someone's ever toothache, and what happens? Screaming, shouting, this, that, and the other. They had restless nights, you know why? Because even their family members said, their mother said to them, why are you not sleeping tonight? Is it because someone's being persecuted? Is it because someone's being tortured? Is it someone's being harmed? And that information has come to you. That's what you call da'wah to salaf. Not just aqidah, not just belief, not just suluk, not just characteristics, that you have a concern of the wider community, that it troubles you. And like as I mentioned, I don't think any of us have gone without food and drink in our lives, or without any real shelter in our lives. I don't think any of us have gone through that real suffering. Then we need to begin to understand what does real suffering mean. So we thank and we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the numerous blessings that we have. Inshallah, I think the brothers made the presentation. I don't know if they're going to be collecting money afterwards for Somalia, the drought and the hardship that the brothers and sisters are facing there. So do be generous on your way out after Qiyamul Layl towards them. So the brothers, especially young brothers who don't seem to care, the elder generation, we advise have taken a lot of interest in trying to help the community, etc. And some of the young brothers still just don't seem to care. If everybody gives a pound each, even today, still becomes a couple of £100, that can feed possibly a whole village. It may sound something minimal to us, it can possibly feed a whole village. So no action should we belittle them or think it's not important. All of us, we can play our part in trying to help you need the wider Muslim Ummah. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take away these hardships and difficulties and unite us all upon the haqq, the truth, upon the true understanding of Quran and Sunnah. Wa qulu qawli hadha wa astaghfiru li wa lakum wa li jami'il muslimin fastaghfiruhu innahu al-ghafurur rahim. Barakallahu fiik.